Indirect Pathways, and I'm going to say the Indirect Pathways because that is the truth. What you'll hear about is the Indirect Pathway as though there is one, but in fact there are many. The truth is, though, that there is one, the primary one can be a stand-in for the rest of them. They all serve a similar purpose. They all suppress competing or rival movements. And if we just follow this one canonical indirect pathway, it is a good way to understand the function of all the indirect pathways. So the indirect pathway that we're going to look at starts in motor cortex and projects these are neurons that project into the striatum. And here, instead of contacting striatal cells that project to the globus pallidus internal, which is the case for the direct pathway, the striatal neurons that are contacted actually project into the external globus pallidus. And these external globus pallidus, all of these cells are all medium spiny neurons. This is all lots of GABA happening here. So the striatal neurons are inhibiting these globus pallidus external cells, which are in turn inhibiting subthalamic neurons. Remember that the subthalamic neurons are the sole excitatory glutamatergic neurons in the basal ganglia. And so they are disinhibited. This inhibiting the inhibition of these cells disinhibits them. So the subthalamic neurons are going to have a boost, an increase in their discharge. And that is going to increase the activity of these output neurons, the internal globus pallidus neurons that project into thalamus. And so there will be more inhibition of the thalamus. And so the effect of having three inhibitory synapses in this entire loop or pathway is that the overall effect is, in fact, inhibitory. Inhibition times inhibition times inhibition. A triple negative, if you will. So the net effect is to inhibit movement, and this is going to inhibit rival movements. So let's consider two different disorders that highlight the function of the indirect pathways. One is, let's consider that there's a lesion right here in subthalamic nucleus. A lesion in the subthalamic nucleus will reduce the excitatory drive on these internal globus pallidus neurons. So there's going to be less inhibition. You will lose inhibition of the thalamic neurons, and that will disfacilitate the motor cortex neurons. So you've lost the inhibition. They're released from that inhibition because there's not as much excitatory drive onto the inhibitory source. And so now you have excess movements. Movements that would have been suppressed, these competing and rival movements that would have been suppressed are now no longer suppressed. And that is the predicted outcome of a lesion of the subthalamic nucleus. Is there anything in life, in clinical neurology, that matches that? Well, yes, there is. It is called hemibolismus. Hemibolismus is a condition that results after a small stroke. So if my right arm is hemibolistic, it's going to make these unwanted ballistic movements, and the movements will be contralateral to the lesion. This is all on one side, and so a loss of the subthalamus on this side affects ipsilateral motor cortex, which affects contralateral movement. So the lesion and the affected movement, the side with the affected movement, are going to be on opposite sides. So the hemibolismus is an important concept. It's often used on boards, and the idea that all hemibolismus stems from lesions of the subthalamic nucleus is frankly incorrect. That is not the case, but a large portion of it does, and it still has that explanatory power. But you should know that there are lesions in multiple other places, in the internal capsule, in the globus pallidus, or even in the striatum, that can give rise to hemibolismus. So there are many other ways to get to the same outcome. The second condition, or in this case, disease, which highlights the workings of the indirect pathway, is called Huntington's disease. Now, Huntington's disease is relatively rare. It is an autosomal dominant disease with 100% penetrance. When people are learning genetics and they want to understand penetrance, they go to Huntington's. If a person has more than 40 CAG repeats in the Huntington gene, the gene is Huntington with an T-I-N. The disease is Huntington's with a T-O-N. Okay, so if there's more than 40 CAG repeats in the Huntington gene, the person will have will develop the disease. They develop it with a low number of repeats or above threshold, but a low number above threshold. They develop it after they've already after the reproductive year. So let's say in their 40s, 50s, 60s, they get Huntington's. So it has been passed on through the generations. As the generations proceed, the number of CAG repeats increases, and with that increase, if there are more repeats, a person will develop it younger and younger. And so some people now develop it even in their teens or in their 20s. It is possible that all Huntington's patients derive from a single person who first developed this. In any case, virtually all individuals who have Huntington's have already seen a parent who died of Huntington's, unless that parent was killed by some other cause before they developed the Huntington's. But in most situations, they've already seen an individual die. And that presages the fact that Huntington's starts out as a movement disorder, but ends with death. Okay, so let me describe a little bit about the symptomatology and experience of Huntington's. It starts out with a loss of the indirect pathway. So it's a loss of these striatal cells that project to the globus pallidus external. And without these cells, there is no suppression of the competing movements. And the movements that are released tend to be slower than ballistic movements. They tend to be choreiform movements. And so these are choreiform. And that's why another name for Huntington's disease is Huntington's chorea. So it's bilateral. This is going to affect both sides. And so these choreiform movements are the first symptoms. For reasons that we'll look at when we look at the various loops, what affects movement will also affect thought and perceptions. And so there is a dementia that progresses along with the movement disorder. That's really not true in Parkinson's. In Parkinson's, there can be cognitive accompaniments, but in Huntington's, there always are cognitive accompaniments. There is also a wasting aspect to this disease. Now, to what extent the constant movement is the reason for the wasting, it remains unclear, but there is a wasting component. And this disease progresses, and after about 15 years is about the average time that a person lives with Huntington's before they die. As the disease progresses, more and more of the striatal cells die. In fact, what you'll see is that the ventricles enlarge. So these cells just disappear. The ventricles come to take over. As you may imagine, as more and more cells die, the striatal cells that are not only involved in the indirect pathways, but also in the direct pathway, as they die, then now it's not just the competing movements that are suppressed, it's also any movement. So just before a person dies or late in the progression of this disease, a person with Huntington's disease will have, will be akinetic. They will not be moving. There'll be no movement. Okay. In 19, 93, the gene was identified. This was a very interesting story. It's worth looking at the history. The identification of the Huntington gene used a large cohort of people, of related people in Venezuela around Lake Maracaibo, to discover the gene that's responsible for Huntington's. And since for some time now, we've had a genetic test that allows people to be tested for the Huntington gene, the Huntington mutation, the repeats. To this day, not too many people take advantage of that test, and one wonders why. And one clear, obvious possibility is that there is absolutely nothing that can be done to halt the progression of Huntington's. There's no treatment. What there is palliative care. So there's palliative care to treat all the symptoms, the injuries. People are going to have problems with their teeth, so the teeth may be removed. There might be treatment for bed sores, etc. So there's going to be palliative care, but nothing that's going to oppose the inexorable progression of the disease. And that is, in my mind, a very reasonable explanation for why most people are not taking advantage of the genetic test. And obviously that has a bioethical component to it. We're going to look at another bioethical treatment, which raises also some other interesting questions. We're going to relook at deep brain stimulation.